In the tags we've created so far, we've kind of ignored the whole topic of what goes in here in these classic settings, these location codes, and these instrument tags. We've kind of ignored that. And the reason we did that is because we actually don't know the answer to that. If you were to ask us, what do we put in there? You know, what do I put in there? The answer to that really depends on what interface you have. For example, if you're using the OPC interface, what you put for those location codes and my instrument tag, that's really going to depend on what's documented here in the online documentation. Let me just go here to the table of contents. You can find within just about each one of these interface documents, you'll find a section on point configuration. So if I go down here to point configuration, you can see that the answer you get is going to depend on what interface you're looking at. A point source is something that you get to choose. Yeah, if you recall, when we used interface configuration utility, we could choose the point source. But other things like location 1, location 2, location 3, etc. Well, it's in general, we have some very specific rules for some of them, like location 1 and location 4. It's very well defined. But for other things like location 2, well, that's just kind of all over the map, and it really depends on the interface. I know this for a fact because when somebody in tech support or field service is going out on a service call to do an installation, the first thing people say is, what interface are you installing? Because depending on what interface it is, that's going to be the difference between whether, you know, you get finished every day at 5 o'clock or at midnight, because some of these interfaces can be painfully difficult to configure. Now, I'll give you an example. We just looked at the OPC interface. That's a pretty straightforward interface, not a lot of tricks to it, but something like this, the Bailey Infinity interface. Let me go to the table of contents here, and I think that's also on page 4. Let's look at the location codes for the Infinity. Now let me go down here. Location codes for the Infinity, I tell you, you really have to know a lot about the Bailey hardware. You know, things like the CIU number, the Bailey PCU portion of the Bailey address for inputs. You know, that kind of stuff really requires that if you are not the person at your site who's really familiar with your control system configuration, you really got to get them involved at this point. Now, chances are they're going to just give you a printout and say, oh, yeah, you see this number right here. This goes in location 1. This goes in location 2, etc. And it's one of those things where, you know, you configure the first one and it's pretty difficult. And you configure the second through the 10 millionth one. It's, you know, you could train a monkey to do it. So it's not that difficult once you've got a few under your belt. And thankfully, if you've got the field service folks from OSI who do the install for you, you know, generally they're not going to create your whole database, but they'll create a few examples and then you just extrapolate from there. So, you know, it's kind of good news and bad news when it comes to how to configure these interfaces. In general, we have some very specific things that, you know, we typically find, but it's going to differ from interface to interface. And the best way to determine, you know, what you're going to put there is going to be to look at the interface documentation. And here's an example. This is the OPC interface. Location 3, in the case of the OPC interface, is where we indicate whether this is a polled or advised tag. And also you can specify output. Now, let's just jump over to the Bailey interface and let's see if we're using location 3 for that same information. It is being used for inputs versus outputs, but as you can see, we don't have that option of, you know, polled versus advised. So it's something that's so specific to the interface that you'd better get out the interface documentation and read it. Now I've jumped back to the OPC interface because what I'd like to do is go one by one through several of the noteworthy parameters here, the noteworthy tag attributes, and just explain what they are for each of these tags, just to use as an example. Let's start with this attribute called the instrument tag. The instrument tag is exactly what it sounds like. It's the name of the piece of instrumentation that you're getting data from on the data source. So if this were a traditional distributed control system, this might be the loop name or the tag name or whatever you call it in your system, the parameter name, the cross-directional scanner position. You know, they have different industries. If you're using a Windows interface to get data performance counters, this would be the performance counter name. It's going to be something that says, go out and get this value. It's an identifier that's local to that you know, that data source that you're retrieving data from. And it's going to be essentially the same thing on just about every interface. So the instrument tag is pretty straightforward. Now, I do want to mention right at this point, those of you who are, you know, dyed-in-the-wool instrument technicians or control system engineers, you may recall that there are many different pieces of equipment that will have one, say, loop name, but that loop name has five or six different parameters or arguments or whatever you might call them. It might have a process value, but also a set point, a status, a valve output. Those actually would have to be four or five separate PI tags. So if you have many different things that are brought in by the control system as a under a single name, typically you'll find that you would make the instrument name the same on all those, and then some of the other things like location codes, for example, might specify what you're trying to read. Is it the set point? Is it the state? Is it the process value, etc.? Now, the extended descriptor, this xdesk field, it's a field that you will find in the point builder. If we go into this general section, you'll find here's the extended descriptor. So each PI tag has one. We use it for a couple of different things in the case of this OPC interface. And there are many interfaces that will do things very similar to this. Now, it's in the extended descriptor that we would specify if this is a tag that's being triggered by the activity of another tag. Let me try to explain. See this syntax right here, event equals tag name? Let me go ahead and paste that into our point definition under extended descriptor. If I were to say my event equals, you know, tag tt115a.pv. If I were to say that, then in the case of the OPC interface, what it's going to do is it's going to look at the activity of this tag, and whenever this tag gets a new, what we call a snapshot value, a new incoming real-time value, then that will trigger this tag to scan and go out and find whatever the value of its source is. So now that's an example of the extended descriptor, just one of the purposes of the extended descriptor. Now you will find the extended descriptor has multi-functions in many interfaces, and generally those are delimited by a semicolon. So if you wanted to add that functionality plus other things, well, let's take a look at what we can do. In the OPC interface, this is where you would also put, if you needed to, an instrument ID that is longer than the 32-character limit. Now that's a real obscurity that you'll probably never see because it just goes back to older versions of the system. But it's an example of the type of, you know, double duty, triple duty, quadruple duty that you find this field being put to at different times. Here's another example, this specifying a D0 for scaled tags. If you read the details on this, you know, when you're bringing in some type of scaled tags, you can basically set, or you use this as a configuration field for configuring how we scale the values coming in from the control system. So these are just three, and I think there are more. Let's see if we find any more. I believe this is also where we specify the format. Yeah, this is where we specify how we read the timestamp under certain circumstances. Here's a bunch of ifs. If you're doing an output tag, and if you want part of the output going back to the control system to be a timestamp, then that's when you get this particular use of the extended descriptor. Now, I think somewhere in here we charitably describe this as, I think we say it's for advanced configuration. Well, I think of it as a dumping ground for everything that doesn't fit anywhere else. And that really does describe its use that we've put over the years. There are just times when there are new functionalities that we need to introduce that we use the extended descriptor to implement them. Now, hey, compare that to this. Here's the extended descriptor in the Bailey Info 90. Bailey Info 90 just doesn't even use the field. Now, since we're talking really about the guts of the configuration of, you know, data sources right now, this would be a good time to bring up the exception deviation and the compression deviation. Although I'll just mention it in passing, really, because we're going to talk a lot more about that later, you know, in the class. We talk all about data compression later. But since we're talking now about getting data from some data source, give it some thought that at some point you're going to want to set some dead bands. For example, I'll say 0.2 engineering units and 0.4, so 4/10 of an engineering unit for this particular tag. These are the two things that we're going to use to help determine how big of a change from one value to the next we need in order to first of all, bring that into the Pi system, and secondly, in order to store it on the archive. Anyway, we'll talk a lot more about that later on, but just keep that in mind. That's very important when you're configuring these types of tags. Now, of course, you need to configure a point source, and that point source needs to correspond to what you configured when you configured the interface. So going back to my interface node now, here's my interface node. As you can see, this OPC interface has a point source of OPC, so this is where the two of these map up together. And there's other things that map that way as well. I think I mentioned earlier when we were talking about the OPC interface, if I've got multiple copies of the interface running, the one way I can distinguish in the log which tags are configured for one interface and which for the other copy, I would do that by this interface ID. And that interface ID maps over here under the classic section to location code 1. That's almost completely universal. You'll see that documented in almost every single one of our interfaces the same way. Let's see if we can verify that here. So if I go into, as you can see, location 1 indicates to which copy of the interface the point belongs. Again, that's going along with the switch that you're setting in the interface when you first configure that interface. Now, and then lastly, we have this thing called the location code. Location code indicates which scan class this particular tag is associated with. And again, back here on the interface node, scan classes are things that you define here. So I've defined a scan class 2 that has 1 second scanning. And so that means that tag you just saw is going to be scanned once every second. Now, if I switch that to a scan class 4 in location code 4, that's going to scan every 2 seconds. See, I would put a 4 in here, save that, and this is going to scan every 2 seconds instead of every 1 second. And finally, there's a field called scan. It's kind of pertinent when we talk about interfaces because this simply turns the scanning off. If I were to turn that off, then the tag continues to exist. We can continue to look at the history of that, but it simply will not be scanned by the interface. Now, just a heads up, if you didn't understand everything that we just went through, please stay tuned for the next two exercises. We're going to configure a ping tag and then an OPC tag.